We will conclude our presentations with a comment by Ruti Tatel, who is Ernst C. Steifel Professor of Comparative Law at the New York Law School. She is a graduate of Georgetown University and Cornell Law School. Professor Tatel is a nationally recognized authority on international law, international human rights, and constitutional law. She is also an expert on Eastern European and Latin American post-totalitarian societies. Among her many publications is her path-breaking book, Transitional Justice, which examines the 20th century transitions from authoritarian to democratic regimes in many countries. Professor Tatel will comment on the various ideas and presentations that we heard in this panel.
The diverse papers we heard cross country lines and historical periods. They go as far back as Zoroastrianism and as far forward as the contemporary Pollard affair to transnational, around the world, Germany and Argentina, diasporas to Israel since its founding. All of them engage with the conference topic regarding Jews and the law and legal and the legal profession. They also build, interestingly, on the first panel on legalism yesterday morning. Now, I thought it was interesting that each author wanted to be the get the prize of the most outside of the subject of the conference. Oh, that's very Jewish, okay? And actually, that's the theme. That's the theme of my comment, and that is that they all share that they resonate with a certain distinctive engagement of Jews and the law, which is an identification of law, a distinct conception of law that relates to a rule of law that stands outside of politics, that has this outsider conception, outside of a law that remains disengaged and apolitical. So I want to talk about these very rich and diverse papers from that perspective. So Mitra Sharafi's paper approaches this theme through the analogy to the Parsi in the Indian legal system. And I thought she began and ended her paper with very interesting comparisons of the Parsi's status and treatment within the law with Jews, in particular the high percentage of lawyers in Germany and in Austria. In comparing with the Parsi in India, she ended her comments with this quote about how they were a peculiar people with no country of their own, no separate national life, but also simultaneously minorities who flourish in the law. And the real question is, what is the coherence of this comment, of the possibility of being a group that flourishes in the law but remains curiously without a national or political aspiration? So that's what I want to explore, is this potentially paradoxical phenomenon. How does it coexist? What view of law does this position represent? And how coherent is it, this conception of a law that is somehow autonomous or independent from politics? What's the legitimacy of it? And I want to say that a lot of the tensions and contradictions that this conception of the law represents are raised interestingly in this panel. So we might go next to the paper by Kenneth Ledford, which delves deeply into this phenomenon as it arose regarding the Jews in Germany. And I thought this paper was a haunting story. In general, we're quite used to a narrative of destruction that commences with the law. The destruction of German and Austrian Jewry beginning in the Nuremberg Laws. But his paper traces a haunting cyclical story of exclusion, then inclusion, assimilation, and then exclusion again. So if you will, a fall, a rise, and a fall. And this is the story of the Jewish status and treatment under the law in Germany. And it has at the heart of it a culture war in Germany that was also played out over the law, which would lead to the simultaneous demise of both Jews and liberalism. This account, the account he gives, raises a lot of questions about Jewish involvement in the legal profession. In many ways, we can see how control of the law and the courts are a paradigm of public life and became a battleground for the fate of liberalism. It's evident in the jurisprudential debates over formalism in legal interpretation at the time. As I mentioned, the narrative that that the Ledford paper tells about the creation of Germany and how there was exclusion at the time, he traces the continuity in exclusions, first how Jews found themselves outside civil society, and then the opening of the law through the 19th century, so that the law, the closing of the law becomes a sign of the persecution, and in fact paradigmatic of it, and always is the first indication of liberalism, and then again the return of discrimination and persecution, and ultimately exclusion from humankind. Now, we are used to thinking about these uses of the law, and he gives us and illuminates a historical provenance which sheds some light on the social acceptability of discriminatory law, its thinkability. As Arendt observed in her claim about banality, almost all of it had happened before, almost all of it short of the genocide. So this is what makes it acceptable. And so a very illuminating part of his story is this historical continuity. But the historical continuity also sheds some light on this interpretive question about the meaning of the law and how these persecutory laws were treated as law. And it takes us to the famous Hart-Fuller debate, the question of whether immoral laws, such as the ones that had were being enacted at the time in Germany, should be treated as law. To what extent should law, which is concededly immoral in its racially discriminatory character, be treated as having the authority of law? Or is bringing this sort of interpretation, a moral interpretation, to bear wild and chaotic, depriving the law of rule of law? Now, in this debate over interpretation, Jewish lawyers took a very clear position. And this gets back to the central theme that I want to explore, and that is that in the battleground over the courts and the law, the Jewish view of this debate was constructed in part as a result of the challenge posed at the time by Carl Schmitt, theorist for the Reich, who as early as the late 1920s, in the concept of the political, expressed the friend-foe distinction as a conception of politics that was necessarily outside of any structure or framework of the law. And he positions himself with respect to the Jewish lawyers, and in particular Hans Kelsen, the influential proponent of formalism. So the fear was that the legal lens would become subject to politicization to their certain detriment. Hard to say which of the reasons predate Schmitt, but in this culture war context, what stands in relief is a view of rule of law seen in formalist positive terms. Likewise, Schmitt in this debate becomes known as the anti-legalist and later anti-Semite. Jewish lawyering becomes identified with a distinctive legal liberalism, which is characterized in terms of a legalism distinctive and disengaged from politics. The harder question is, to what extent is this formalism a Jewish phenomenon, itself a protective reaction against law as representing the will of a majority community and oppressive politics, that is, law conceived as a product of others' politics?